I'm here today to talk about AWS Lambda and Go and how they play well together, or what you could benefit from doing Lambda and Go together. But first, let me start by talking a bit about what serverless really is. What's serverless? There's serverless, the term is around for like 2 or 3 years now. AWS started the whole movement around serverless, and currently I think it's best described by the serverless manifesto. Maybe you've seen it already. There are 8 points which characterize a serverless solution, starting by with point one, function are the unit of deployment and scaling, which means that you deploy exactly one function and not your whole project. It's a bit like microservices, maybe. You shouldn't have to care about VMs, containers, physical machines. That's all hidden away, abstracted away. Okay. So for the recording, reicht es, wenn ich einmal die Folien kurz durchklicke bis dahin? Okay, so now it's all also recorded. Functions are the unit of deployment. No machines, no virtual machines, no containers. You don't have to care about it. Stateless services, there's no persistent state in the functions you're using. So you have to use some other service that provides you with persistent storage. Scaling is per request. That's one of the main selling points of serverless architectures, that you can't under-provision or over-provision, because you only pay what you're really using, so you don't have to pay for idle. That's point five. It's implicitly fault-tolerant. The clustering, scheduling stuff behind the scenes takes care of finding live and healthy machines. You can bring your own code, so you don't have to like click through wizards, or you can bring your own code and own binaries, own shared libraries, but not your own container images. And to get visibility in all that abstract, abstracted away infrastructure, there's metrics and loggings, logging that's really needed and has to be in each serverless architecture. It's a universal right, basically. So how does a serverless service look like? For example, AWS Lambda, that's not exactly a complete serverless ecosystem, but it's only function as a service offering. So in what you can do with AWS Lambda is you write your code in Java, Python, Node, C#, package it up, upload it to Amazon, and once a request arrives for it, the clustering software behind the scenes will take care of finding a machine, instantiating the container, and processing your request and giving you back an answer. There are two ways of scaling AWS Lambda. You can scale vertically by modifying the amount of memory that one function has available. With the memory, also the CPU and network I/O available to the container increases. So a 128 megabyte function or a 256 megabyte function has twice the amount of CPU and network I/O available as a 128 megabyte function has. You can also scale horizontally by writing your application in a way that multiple Lambda functions are called concurrently. So that's your way of horizontally scaling. And the key point you pay by 100 millisecond increments of runtime. If you're interested in how the costs add up, you can go to serverlesscalc.com. There's a small interface where you can put in number of requests per month, average runtime per request, how much memory you need, and then you can select a serverless offering. Besides AWS Lambda, there's Apache OpenWhisk, or I think the pricing is still on IBM OpenWhisk, but that's the same. And Google Functions or an Azure Functions, Google Cloud Functions and Azure Functions. So there you can get an impression on how much it will cost. For most use cases, it's really in the low single digit dollar amounts. But as I've said, AWS Lambda is only the heart of a serverless solution. The real benefit from it comes if you add additional services. And I've picked out a couple of more important ones just to illustrate that. For example, if you want to drive an HTTP API with Lambda, just with Lambda you can't. It's not possible because Lambda cannot be called via HTTP. To enable this, you have to create an API gateway that then calls the Lambda function. To take the no persistent storage point from earlier in account, you have to have some kind of persistent storage. There you have S3, the simple storage service, one of the oldest AWS services around, where you can store blobs of data. Then you have the NoSQL database, DynamoDB. You could also use RDS, the relational database service, where you have MySQL, Postgres, or even Oracle. That's also possible to call from Lambda. It's not the easiest one because you have to care about connection pools and stuff like that. That makes it a bit more complicated. So much for the persistent storage. But the services on the left side enable you to come up with more complex workflows. So you seldomly have like only one single Lambda function doing something. So you need a queuing service, simple queuing service, or a publish-subscribe mechanism, which you get by using simple notification service. Or if you want, which is from what I've seen, one of the more interesting services or the more important services around in AWS is CloudWatch events, where you can react to certain events happening in your AWS cloud. For example, an EC2 instance starting or configuration changes, or you could have a cron pattern trigger your Lambda function every now and then. That you can do with CloudWatch events. And if that's not enough, you can build even more complex workflows and long running workflows, like days or months even, by using step functions where you can have a Amazon hosted state machine that's driven by Lambda functions. So we got a basic tool set which we can use for driving our infrastructure, our cloud application. If you want to add monitoring and observability into the mix, there's also CloudWatch logs, CloudWatch metrics, and X-ray for tracing requests across Lambda functions and across services. And what can we do with serverless? There's lots of use cases for it, and there's one common topic on these I picked out because personally that's, yeah, in my opinion, there's one really, really good use case for using Lambda, and that's not driving APIs. You can do all that. You can transform logs, build up data pipelines. But I think the main use case for Lambda, it can be that you automate your infrastructure with it, because it's so deeply integrated into the whole of AWS. In all services, you find triggers for Lambda. So you can monitor databases, react to infrastructure changes, run tests, periodic tasks, automate certain deployment workflows, stuff like that. And of course, there's also the hello world of serverless architectures. You can resize images with it. That's one of the first examples you see in every guide or how to. That's also possible, but the main thing is you can drive your DevOps efforts and drive your cloud with Lambda. But now we have the theory about it, and we still need to practically do it. And for that, we need a platform that fits all our requirements. And I've written some down from which we can go to selecting a programming language that suits our needs, because we don't want to we all don't have time for driving our cloud automation and infrastructure automation, because it's often enough more of a side job, or because we just want to drive our business forward, implement features and stuff, and that's often not automation. So it should be fast to develop. We want easy tooling support, preferably if you're coming from Java. I'm personally a Java developer. I'm used to IntelliJ or Eclipse providing me good code completion, good documentation, refactoring, stuff like that. So this is one requirement. There should be fast deployments, because we don't want to handle like 200 megabytes of deployment artifacts just for a single small Lambda function. And there's also a limit with 50 megabytes, but yeah. So it should be overall a lightweight solution with good performance. We don't have the sub-millisecond requirements like ad bidding platforms or real-time trading platforms have. So performance is somehow important, but we don't have like it has to answer after 5 milliseconds or something like that. For our use case with cloud automation, it shouldn't be that slow, but doesn't matter if the 99 or 99.5 percentile is somewhere around like 300 or 400 milliseconds, or once in a while, half a second. So good performance, should be easy to learn. Maybe it's the normal software developers need to pick it up besides their main primary language, or something like that. And we need good libraries and SDKs for the cloud to interface with other cloud services, interface inside AWS, stuff like that. So there are, I think, two questions. Which platform do we want to use, or which programming language, and which framework we want to use for automation? Because if you've ever done anything in the serverless space, configure Lambda functions, stuff like that, it's getting really complex, really, really fast. So if you're stuck with the web console, it's you're going nowhere. So for the platform, for the programming language, I came up with a highly subjective classification of the programming languages. On the left, we have like the programming languages currently supported on AWS, on Lambda. And on top, there are some requirements we have. Like to enable all the fast development, IDE support, stuff like that, it would be nice to have static types, because most of the time the IDEs do the code completion stuff right if you have static types. We want a nice deployment. It shouldn't be that much work. Startup performance is something we need to consider. Also runtime performance and the whole ecosystem with a focus on DevOps and cloud automation, infrastructure automation. So you see, Node.js and Python are fast, but they don't have static types. And personally, I wouldn't want to do Node.js. Yeah, you could, but then you're stuck with a less than optimal library ecosystem. Because, for example, the AWS SDK, do they have typings for it? Okay. Yeah, so that's an edge case. You can use TypeScript. But yeah, so, and there's Python, they don't have static types either. You can have fast deployment, startup time is really great, same with Node.js. Both languages are one of the first languages supported on Lambda. For the interpreted languages, the runtime performance is a bit is not so great. That's where the compiled languages really shine. And there's a good ecosystem. I mean, Python is used for all kinds of cloud automation. It's somewhat the DevOps, one of the DevOps languages around. Also Node.js to some part, I think. As I said, it's highly subjective. Java is really great with static types. You can get your IDE support. That's great, but you have to package up jars. And startup performance is really bad because you have to, the whole JVM has to boot, and the hotspot has to get hot. But then again, runtime performance is really great because once all the optimizations kick in, Java and also C#, they're really, really good and really fast. But both aren't really the lingua franca of DevOps people. It's not that people wrote Docker in Java. So what can we do about it? We don't have a like clear choice. So maybe we heard of that Docker of Go and wanted to try that because it's used in Kubernetes, Docker, traffic, all the HashiCorp tools use it. So, but it's somehow it's possible. You can run arbitrary executables in AWS Lambda. You can even run scripting languages. That's a bit weird. Like PHP, Ruby, and Go in Lambda. And here the table looks a bit different. We got static types. Deployment is a bit of a hassle because we have to find a workaround on how to start the binaries. Startup performance is a bit lacking because we have to use either Node or Python to start the actual Go binary. But then runtime performance is really great, and we have all these concurrency primitives available to us. And because most of the tools around in the DevOps scene or DevOps tooling are written in Go, we have a huge set of libraries available to us. So just to recap, why do we want to use Go? Static type system, fast tooling, fast compiles. It's easy to compile. Go compiles down to a static binary. It's made to be easy to learn. That was one of the main objectives that Google was following. And it's really popular for systems programming, Docker, HashiCorp, etc. So, platform set. What can we do about the framework? There's, of course, the web console where you can put in your code. That doesn't work for us because we need to deploy a package of Node.js or Python, which in turn then calls our Go binary. So we can't just write our code here. That's only for Node and Python. And we obviously, because we want to have like a large infrastructure or multiple services, at some point we would need some kind of infrastructure as code. There's CloudFormation. That's one of the obvious choices in AWS. Especially in larger enterprises, there's often the requirement everything has to be specified in CloudFormation, or there are alternatives, Terraform, stuff like that. But it tends to be hard to maintain. The maintainability lacks a bit, and it tends to be really to get really verbose. That's only one snippet out of a really, really large template, or could be a snippet out of a really, really large template. They can easily go over 2,000, 3,000 lines of code. Amazon tried to improve that by providing the serverless application model. That's some kind of abstraction on top of CloudFormation, which provides resources that encapsulate larger serverless concept. For example, a serverless function, which if this resource is created, it will create associated roles and stuff like that, so you don't have to care about it. But that's really hard to maintain, and it doesn't really fit together. It doesn't really fit well together with our objective of using Go. There are other frameworks, for example, a serverless framework or Apex. And what they have in common is they provide you with a configuration file, where often YAML or JSON, where you can specify all your Lambda functions, your handlers, your roles, all the wiring in between Lambda functions or other services. But it tends to be at some point it's getting hard, and it doesn't fit well together with Go. So what can we do with Lambda and Go? Before we dive into one of the frameworks that solves this really, really great, I want to briefly show you how the actual handler looks like for calling Go. That's the minimal example on how you can call a binary. It's just Node.js. You use the child process module, reference the Go binary, put the event that you're getting passed in for your Lambda, make a string out of it, pass it as an argument, and you're done. At least in theory. Because you have all this cold start behavior, meaning a Lambda function is around for the execution, and then it's frozen. And if you send an event right after, chances are quite good that the existing container is unfrozen, and you get like a fully initialized container, and you don't have to wait that long for your Lambda to start. And what we are doing here is we are just calling our binary every time we get an event, and there's no caching, no nothing involved here. So it would be nice if we had a framework that handles all these aspects of caching our binary or keeping it running or something like that. And it turns out there is gosparta.io. It's a really nice framework handling all these integration problems you have with Lambda. And I want to briefly show you how it works. So, so you got your main.go, And once you run it, you'll see an interface with commands you can run. And that single binary, or here I'm running in script mode, and that single binary contains everything you need to develop your Lambda, build your Lambda, deploy your Lambda, and the actual handler code, and all the CloudFormation stuff. So if I now deploy this, or provision this, Spada tries to compile it. There's some magic happening here with CGo because I'm using the optimized handler, which I'll show in a second. But normally just using the standard Go compiler. And then after compilation is finished, it's uploading it to the binary and the wrapper to S3. It's generating a CloudFormation template, creating a CloudFormation stack at Amazon. That takes us some seconds. And then we're ready to go. Just a second. We can have a look at CloudFormation in the meantime. So here we have our stack. And right now we are... Ah, it's finished. So what did it do? It created IAM roles, created a code bundle, uploaded the code, created a CloudFormation stack containing IAM roles and the actual Lambda function. And we're ready to go. If we want to... So, yeah, let me show it to you. So here we have now a Lambda function. And we can test it. This should be a cold start right now. So, yeah, it took almost a second. But subsequent calls should be way faster, like 100 milliseconds. And that's only one feature the command line has. It can also delete and stuff like that. But what it also can do is it can describe our... It can describe our setup we created now with Sparta. Takes a while. In the meantime, we'll... Ah, it's done. Open. So we are getting an HTML output, and we only defined one handler function. That's this orange box here. If you would define like additional triggers, other services, stuff like that, it would also show up here. And now the thing here is gone. And we can show, can view the CloudFormation template that was generated. And before we look into the CloudFormation template, I want to briefly show you how the actual Go code looks like. So some imports, and this is basically everything you need to do to get a hello world using Go on Lambda. Specify the handler function. The interface is taken from the net/HTTP package, so it could possibly also be integrated into a web server. So it's a standard interface. And then you have to like specify what your handler functions are, specify an empty role, and give it a name, and you're good to go. But if we look at the CloudFormation template, there's a lot more going on here. For example, there's an IAM role. Remember the Go code? The IAM role was empty. But here there's all kinds of stuff in there. Permissions to use CloudWatch logs, permissions to use CloudWatch metrics, put metric data, permissions to use describe stacks. That's for configuration, because inside your Lambda, you can call a discover function and get to know your surrounding infrastructure for configuration. And you got your permission to use X-Ray for putting traces. And, of course, the actual Lambda function. So much for the demo. There's also the possibility to run your Lambda function locally. Then it's just bringing up a HTTP server on port on some port, and you can play with your Lambda function locally via curl, just as you're used to, or Postman, or whatever you want to use. You can just post event data there and get the response. So testing is also covered. Let's delete it and back to the slides. Okay, so it really doesn't take much to implement a simple hello world. Sparta takes care of handling all your all the wrapping you need to do, takes care of optimizing how it's done and caching everything. We'll look at that later. We have certain commands. You saw it in the demo already. We covered everything. How does it really work? What's happening behind the scenes? If you look into one of the zip files created, here it's the one of the more the easier wrapper functions using Node.js. And there's the binary in it, one index.js containing the wrapping logic, and there's protobuf node modules and some utilities. And what's happening there is, to overcome the cold start problems and stuff like that, what they're doing is starting the binary with the first request a fresh container gets, and starting up an HTTP server. And then they are sending the request serialized using protobuf to the HTTP server. Processing is done inside the Go binary, and then it's passed back up again, also using protobuf to Node.js, and then the response is returned. Or if you're doing async, you don't have a response. But there's also an alternative. Go has the ability to compile to shared libraries or binaries that you can use from languages like C, or then use it in Python as a native module. And Matt Weigel from Sparta wrote the C-Go adapter, which is basically a Python native module or a shared library used in Python. And so you get rid of all the HTTP stuff going on inside the Lambda. And that turns out to be around 50% faster. Faster in respect or to cold start times or startup time. It doesn't matter. If the processing is hard here, it doesn't matter. Yeah, but the overhead is 50% less. So what do we need to do to get the C-Go part up and running? It's just the matter of changing an import. And one line of code in the main function. And everything else is magic. Sparta is rewriting your Go code, changing the main function to init function. So it does fit the requirements you have to for interfacing with Python. And then the zip file really looks less interesting. It's just index.py and the binary and the wrapper. That's everything. I cut out some error handling logic, but it's basically just getting the event, building up some context you only have in the outside handler function, passing it to the library, reading back the response. That's everything that's happening in Python. For Node.js, there's also some metric collection and stuff like that happening. So we talked a lot about how Sparta overcomes Go not being supported in AWS natively. But there's a... I'm losing my microphone. But there's more to it in sorry. There's more to it in Sparta. Because they have this, I call it vision, of everything as code. Everything you need to do with your serverless architecture using Sparta, you can do in Go code. So, for example, all setting up the security-related stuff, like IAM roles, there's a concept for that where you specify IAM role privileges, set up actions on resource. Anybody who has ever written IAM roles, policies, and stuff like that, that's way easier. And it's, for some parts, sure, the actions aren't type-safe, but it's way easier to write and less code. They even took care about or thought about how to include encrypted config variables. Might not be the best solution, but they are thinking about all possible or all needed features to have a production ready setup. Preferably you would want to look at parameter store in AWS or something like that if you ever want to do it. Earlier I talked about API gateway. They have it built in. You can just specify your handler function, say which resource it should be on. That's happening here. And create an API gateway and you're good to go. It's generating your cloud, the whole CloudFormation template, which for API gateway is really a lot to write. That's really easy to do. If you want to wire together your infrastructure components, like for the famous image resizing example, you want to use permissions. AWS is calling it event triggers. Sparta calls it permissions because there's a lot of IAM roles and policies going on behind the scenes. And there you just specify your S3 bucket, which actions you want to subscribe on, and you're good to go. And here you would get notified for object created and object removed. So that's one of the easier parts. Of course, there's integrations for CloudWatch events, Kinesis, DynamoDB, all the additional resources you can have in a serverless setup. Building more complex workflows using step functions is also possible here in a type-safe way. So you have all your, if you think about clean code applied to your infrastructure, you have all kinds of possibilities to structure your code, your infrastructure. Maybe even generating it dynamically. So there you really get all kinds of refactorings that are possible and that make it really nice to use. thinking about step functions, they might be really, really large, and there you want to have some kind of structure to it, and that's not a YAML file that goes over 1,000 lines. For sure, you want to use some kind of custom infrastructure, additional, a Kinesis stream, an S3 bucket, something like that. Sparta has you covered here as well. You can just specify a S3 bucket, add it as a resource, and you're good to go. They behind the scenes, they're using the Go CloudFormation package, which provides type-safe structs for almost all CloudFormation resources available. They are like scanning it once a day, scanning the documentation and generating pull requests nightly. So they are pretty up to date, and that's a huge thing because you can just generate CloudFormation. I'm coming to that later. Testing is also covered. It does integrate perfectly with the Go test workflow because the handler functions are using the standard HTTP handler interface. You can just create a HTTP test server and run your tests locally. And if you want to test it manually, there's also the explore command. If you're testing, you also want to do continuous integration, continuous delivery. The commands I showed you earlier are realized through the Cobra package, and that you can use to extend Sparta even further. And for there's a code example on GitHub where you can add a provision pipeline command, which there's some code in code behind it, but what it does is it generates a AWS code pipeline that's completely set up to build your Sparta application, run the tests, create a change set at CloudFormation, and apply the change set at CloudFormation, all in a serverless manner, all configured automatically. Monitoring is also covered. There's a decorator which you can add to your Lambda functions, which then creates a dynamic, dynamically creates a CloudWatch dashboard. These are really hard to create automatically. Have done it at a client recently. It's hell to create automatically. It's so it's templating going on there, and it's giving you an overview of all your Lambda functions and provides you shortcuts to your logs of all Lambda functions and to the documentation and stuff like that. So overall, it's pretty extensible. There are all kinds of hooks that can be implemented. You can use Sparta to drive custom resources for CloudFormation. If you want to integrate other services that should be handled inside the CloudFormation workflow, for example, integrating a third-party DNS provider or something like that, that you can also do. You can have extra commands like the pipeline command. There's also the possibility to have environment-specific configurations, so you can have different environments, different stages, and the whole workflow from building your Lambda to having that zip file and uploading it to S3 and creating the CloudFormation template. There are all kinds of hooks possible where you can integrate your custom logic and, for example, add additional files to the zip file if you need any resources on your Lambda function in the container then. So, as a conclusion to Sparta, it's a really, really nice, well-integrated solution with where Matt Weigel put really a lot of thought into it. Even providing, if you look at the documentation, for every example, like the CI/CD example, he's describing it, and at the bottom, he's providing you with the theory behind it. So there's for the monitoring thing, he's citing Werner Vogel's "You Build It, You Run It," and there's a link to ACMQ for the article where he found it. And that's one of the. It's really interesting to see that it seems that a lot of best practices are implemented here. And there's also the explanation for it in the documentation. So Sparta helps you with lots of best practices, all the IAM role handling, living least privilege principle, all that stuff. That's all in there. So it's a really nice solution for writing your cloud automation code or serverless code. There are alternatives, especially the AWS Lambda Go Shim. They provide a not so well integrated, but they provide the wrapper logic, but not the whole tooling around it. And there's Apex, which is basically supporting everything, I think. But they have configuration files, so you don't you cannot write everything in Go code, for example. But it's written in Go. So summing up, I would say AWS Lambda and Go really well together. It's fun to write. It's a nice language. It works well in Lambda, even though there's no native support. Personally, I can live with the workaround calling into the Python library, because for my use cases that I'm thinking of in terms of cloud automation and infrastructure automation, I don't need like ultra performance all the time, because in Lambda there's always a function call that goes up to 1 second or something. That happens. But if you are reacting to an EC2 instance starting up, that will take 2 to 5 minutes or something like that, then 100 milliseconds don't matter. So I wouldn't use it for driving your high traffic APIs that are user facing and where you lose money if you increase your latency by 20% or something, but for automation it's perfectly fine. So I would even go one step further and say AWS cloud infrastructure and Go, they match perfectly. And for that I brought an additional example. AWS published GoFormation, which is basically the same as the library that Sparta uses. And they provide a really nice interface to creating cloud formation inside Go. And here's a small example which should illustrate what I think is a really nice use case for it. There are other projects doing it. There's Troposphere, Sparkle, which help you templating cloud formation. But here, for example, let us create a security group. And there should be 3 ports allowed, SSH, HTTP, and HTTPS up here. And normally I would need to write ingress rules for port 22, port 80, port 443. And here I can just loop over them. That's more one of the simpler examples, but thinking of how we use CloudFormation in the enterprise at clients, they, for example, have this requirement that you have to have all resources have to be tagged with cost reference, project ID, stuff like that. And if you write your CloudFormation in Go, you can easily traverse your whole resource tree and just add the tags. And you don't have like 2,000 lines of CloudFormation, of which 60% are just tags you need to add to be compliant to your company's rules. So I think that's a huge chance there to benefit from this. And that's the output you get when you run the example. So you're still using CloudFormation, you would still have the ability to just have a CloudFormation template at some point. So it's not a lock-in on any Go library or something like that, but it's just means of templating your CloudFormation. Overall conclusion, I think it's really an easy choice for DevOps automation or infrastructure automation if you're doing CloudFormation, if you're doing AWS. The overall startup times are okay. I didn't talk much about performance because for me it doesn't really matter. The tooling is really, really great. It's fun to do. It's easy to use, easy to integrate, easy to extend. And it's a ongoing living project. And maybe the future will bring native integration into AWS. We'll see next week. Next week's reInvent. We'll see what will happen there. That's it. Thanks to Matt Riegel for GoSpotter.io. And yeah, that's it.